Welcome to worship this second Sunday of Easter as we continue in the 50 great days of celebrating this season. It's wonderful to have you here today, especially so because we together today get to celebrate and get to share in the sacrament of holy baptism for Nolan, Charles, Rourke, Davis. I think I've got all the names right there. Yes. All right. So it's an especially happy Easter day as we continue in that today. And just a joyous moment to share in with everybody today. Before we get started further with that, I'll ask if there's any announcements to share this morning.
There's a sign-up sheet back here for the fifth Sunday after the 11 o'clock service next week. So please remember to sign up. It's all your time.
I am a member of Springfield Mid-America Singers. I want to encourage you to go to a free concert at Redeemer Lutheran Church next Sunday, 3 o'clock. Okay? Come this fall, we're going to celebrate our 50th anniversary. And we've been 50 years singing along, so it's going to be quite an event. Commissioned a thing we're supposed to sing. So this next Sunday will be Requiem for the Living, 3 o'clock on Redeemer Lutheran. Thank you. Next Sunday.
All right. Thank you. Other announcements? Okay. With that then, let us share today in the Easter greeting as we continue in this Easter season. It's Alleluia, Christ is risen, and you're going to respond, He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Okay? So, Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Alleluia is such a wonderful word for this season. And through our baptism today, we have an extra opportunity to share in that word. There's so many ways to sing it. What I want to invite you to do today, a little bit once we get into the baptism, is to join me in singing what's known as the Celtic Alleluia. So we're going to practice that just a little bit right now. It goes like this. There's only one word to remember, Alleluia, so that's the easy part, all right? It goes like this. Alleluia, Alleluia. Okay, can you join me in that part? Alleluia, Alleluia. And we just kind of continue again with that. Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. So we're just going to, there's going to be a point coming up soon. I'm going to invite you to join me in that. And we're just going to sing that. All right? All right. So with that, let us begin worship.
Thank you.
Please be seated. I invite the parents and sponsors of Nolan and any of his family who'd like to gather around to join me around the font here at this time. Now today, as I'm guest still among you, we were looking for the slides to go with baptism, didn't quite locate those. So we're going to go just a little bit old school today, and I'm going to invite you to pick up one of the red worship books in the pews, and if you'd like to join along in the rite of holy baptism with me, that begins on page 227 in the front section of the hymnal. So in the front section, there are page numbers along the bottom. Look for page 227. God, who is rich in mercy and love, gives us a new birth into a living hope through the sacrament of baptism. By water and the word, God delivers us from sin and death and raises us to new life in Jesus Christ. We are united with all the baptized in the one body of Christ, anointed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and joined in God's mission for the life of the world. I invite the sponsors to present Nolan, just joining me in saying, I present Nolan Charles for baptism. Right. Called by the Holy Spirit, trusting in the grace and love of God, do you desire to have your son baptized into Christ? If so, say, I do. As you bring your son, Nolan, to receive the gift of baptism, you are entrusted with responsibilities to live with him among God's faithful people, to bring him to the Word of God and the Holy Supper, teach him the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments, place in his hands the Holy Scriptures, and nurture him in faith and prayer, so that your son may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others in the world God made, and work for justice and peace. Do you promise to help your son Nathan grow in the Christian faith and life? If so, say, I do. Sponsors, do you promise to nurture this child in the Christian faith as you are empowered by God's Spirit and to help him live in the covenant of baptism and in communion with the church? If so, say, I do.
I do.
People of God, do you promise to support Nolan Charles Rourke and to pray for him in his new life in Christ? If so, say together, we do. Let us share together in the creed and the confession of our faith. We begin by renouncing. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God? If so, say, I renounce them. Do you renounce the powers of this world that rebel against God? I renounce them. Do you renounce the ways of sin that draw you from God? Join me in the creed. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. The Lord be with you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight. Through the waters of the flood you delivered Noah and his family, and through the sea you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river, your son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you set us free from the power of sin and death and raise us up to live in you. Pour out your Holy Spirit, the power of your living word, that those who are washed in the waters of baptism may be given new life. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ, our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Hello, no. Yes. Yeah. All right. Ready to get a little wet? Or maybe even a lot wet today. Yeah. All right. The water's nice and warm here. Nolan Charles Wark, I baptize you in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Yeah, that was great, wasn't it? Remember that hallelujah we practiced? Now's the time for that. Okay. So let us sing together. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. All right. Welcome, Nathan. Welcome, Nathan, my brother. Yeah. Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through the water and the Holy Spirit, you give your daughters and sons new birth. Cleanse them from sin and raise them to eternal life. Sustain Nolan Charles' work with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the Spirit of your presence, both now forever. Amen. We're almost there, yeah. Nolan Charles Rourke, child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Amen.
I am the light of the world. Jesus said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will have the light of life.
Let us welcome the newly baptized. Let us welcome Nolan. We welcome you into the body of Christ and into the mission we share. Join us in giving thanks and praise to God and bearing God's creative and redeeming word to all the world. All right. Welcome. Welcome. Peace be with you, Nolan. Peace be with you. And peace be with all of you. Let us share Christ's peace. Share it with Nolan, share it with one another. The Holy Gospel according to John. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Judeans, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord, and Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them, and he said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. There is an ancient hymn that goes back to the 1400s that I want to share with you today. And I know that that goes maybe perhaps a little bit against the contemporary design of this service, but I want you to not doubt and to not have any fear in this, okay? "O sons and daughters" is how it begins. O sons and daughters, what a wonderful way to connect all of us with the baptism that just joined us to Nolan as our brother and sister. "O sons and daughters, let us sing with heavenly hosts to Christ our King. Today the grave has lost its sting. Alleluia! That Easter morn at break of day, the faithful women went their way to seek the tomb where Jesus lay. Alleluia! An angel clad in white they see, who sits and speaks unto the three, your Lord will go to Galilee. Alleluia." This is a great hymn. It helps remind us of the Easter story we heard just last Sunday as it begins. Your Lord will go to Galilee is what it invites us to remember. Your Lord will go to Galilee and he will meet you there. This is the gospel promise that we have heard. But this promise, the promise of the empty tomb, well, it's more than just a promise. It also contains an expectation, a mission for the disciples. The mission that is fundamental to this promise is that those whom the Lord will meet, well, they actually have to go forth, right? If he's going to meet them in Galilee, they need to get going. They cannot hunker down. They cannot remain sheltered. They cannot remove themselves from the roadways and the intersections of God's world. Yes, the people who receive the gospel promise of Easter are being sent out. They're being sent out. Out to Galilee, out through Samaria, out to Syria, to Lebanon, to Corinth, to Rome, to all the world. They are being sent out. In fact, that's what the word apostles means. Those who are sent, those who go out, those who go forth. But here we are today, and the witness that John is bringing to us is that the disciples were not going out. They were not on their way to Galilee or to anywhere else. They were hunkered down. They were staying put. They were staying behind closed and locked doors. In a way, John's testimony, well, it became true not only of those first disciples on that first day of Easter following Christ's resurrection, but in many ways it became true for the church itself. Since the very first Easter day when the angel announced, "He is going before you," a chronic temptation for Christ's church has been to not go, but to stay behind closed doors, to stay safely within the world of the private and the personal. Behind such a closed door, well, the dilemmas of spiritual, family, and personal concerns, they can be handled safely within, right? Carefully. Behind such a closed door, the message of the gospel can be received and embraced without worrying about embarrassment, without risk, without exposure. Beyond that door, though, on the other side, beyond, are the risky public and social worlds that occupy our lives. Beyond that door are the economic, the political, and the civic realities that occupy most of our waking hours. Beyond that door, the gospel's promise, well, often it's scarcely acknowledged. It can be dimly glimpsed. And quite often, it can be considered just simply quite out of place beyond that door. Is a world that can threaten us with betrayal, with death, with failure, embarrassment, and yes, with doubt and with fear. That ancient hymn, that ancient song goes on like this: "The night the apostles met in fear, among them came their master dear and said, my peace be with you here. Alleluia." When Thomas first the tidings heard that they had seen the risen Lord, he doubted the disciples' word. Alleluia. He doubted the disciples' word. Alleluia. Those are crazy things to put together, right? A little ridiculous sounding. It's not the kind of statement that we usually put with an alleluia. Alleluia is supposed to go with something positive, something like, Christ is risen.
Alleluia.
Praise the Lord.
Alleluia.
Peace be with you.
Alleluia.
Alleluia fits there, doesn't it? But he doubted the disciples' word? Hallelujah. It doesn't go Thomas's doubt is what we have come to call it. But it wasn't Thomas's doubt alone. It was the same doubt that kept all of the other 12 locked up behind closed doors in the first place. At least Thomas on that first day had the courage to be out somewhere. No, Thomas was not alone. And the disciples, well, they had their doubts of fear. The doubt of accusations that would be coming their way. The doubt of persecutions that they might face. The doubt of the cross upon which they themselves might soon be hung. All of these doubts kept the disciples behind closed doors. But those doors and those locks, they do not keep the risen Jesus out. Suddenly, Jesus stands there among them with a proclamation that the peace that he promised through his ministry has now been achieved in his resurrection, in his ascension, and in his glorification. Peace be with you, he proclaims. Peace be with you. But it is an unexpected sort of peace. A peace not given according to the expectations of this world. The peace that Jesus gives is not the peace of retirement. It's not the peace of government law or a strong military. It's not even the peace of a relaxing day at the lake or the peace of a restful night of sleep. Rather, the peace that Jesus brings and gives is a peace that comes with a new status, a new role. The ones who receive Jesus' peace, you see, are no longer merely disciples. In receiving this peace, they become apostles. They are the ones who are now sent out into the world. Just as God sends Jesus himself, peace be with you, as my Father has sent me, so I send you. Jesus' peace is a peace that pushes the Christian community, both then and now, pushes us. It's a peace that sends us outward from the rooms and the spaces in which we want to find safety. It's a peace that pushes us to undo the locks, to go forth into a world where good and evil will be wrestling, to go forth into a world that can be and is threatened by destruction. And yet, at the same time, into a world that lives in hope of the fulfillment of God's promises. This is the peace that Jesus brings among us, a peace that sends us out from this room right now to be apostles. Not apostles because we know all things, or not apostles because we have certainty in our knowledge, or that we can answer all the questions and doubts of faith. but to go forth as apostles, because that is who God makes us to be. In sending the Holy Spirit, the same Holy Spirit that we just encountered in baptism, God's own creative breath, in sending that Spirit into our hearts and into our lungs and into our very being, we are made apostles. It is the peace of baptism. It is the peace of a new commission, a charge to carry that same holy breath, that same holy water, that same holy peace to others, and to exercise a sanctifying influence in the midst of a world that struggles. This is the peace that makes each and every one of you an apostle. Now, I can see it in some of your faces, maybe a little bit in your body language too. There's a little bit of doubt out there. Are we really being sent in this way? There's doubt that I might be called and sent into such public situations, into possibly vulnerable situations, into struggles where there is no certainty. Doubt that the word apostle applies to us. But in the midst of such doubt, there is also the hope and the faith that emerges. Because rooted in doubt is also the kernel and the seed of what might be. Because in the very act of doubting, that we are apostles, we must also entertain the possibility that we are. It's part of the doubt. It goes with the space. In doubting that we are sent, we must also face the belief that we are actually sent. Alleluia! And so, you see, it is not doubt, not Thomas's, not the disciples', not ours, that keeps us from the action of peace to which Jesus calls us. It's simply a little bit of fear. It's simply fear that keeps us within the safety of some closed doors, that keeps us from being the apostles that Jesus calls us to be. Simply fear. Alleluia. I say alleluia here because it is precisely this little bit of fear, this separating fear, which Jesus conquers when he gives us that peace. The fear that we are alone, it's gone in peace be with you. The fear that we might be forgotten, gone. Peace be with you. The fear that we may not be loved, the fear that we are unworthy, the fear that we may die, gone, gone, gone. Peace be with you. This is the ultimate life-giving power of Christ's peace, a peace that cannot be contained by any lock, by any door, by any wall, by any basin of water. A peace that is not obstructed by any of our fears. And for that peace, we can indeed say, alleluia. For Thomas's doubt, alleluia. For our doubt, alleluia. For all the doubt which creates a space for Jesus to come and see and say to each one of us, my peace is with you. That ancient hymn comes to a close like this. My pierced side, O Thomas, see, and look upon my hands, my feet. Not faithless, but believing be. Alleluia! No longer Thomas then denied, he saw the feet, the hands, the side. You are my Lord and God, he cried. Alleluia! How blessed are they who have not seen, and yet whose faith has constant been, for they eternal life shall win. On this most holy day of days, be laud and jubilee and praise. To God your hearts and voices raise. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Rejoicing in the risen life of Christ, let us pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. We pray for the church. Breathe your spirit into us. Renew us with your power. Unite us in mission. And send us into the world with your love. Lord, in your mercy. For the earth, for fields and forests, gardens and vineyards, and all newly planted crops. Sustain our world with clean water and favorable weather. Lord, in your mercy. For the nations, empower leaders to work with the well-being of all. Send peace into every place where people live in the shadow of violence and displacement. Free all who are isolated behind walls of fear. Lord, in your mercy, for those in need, look with compassion toward those who bear hidden wounds. Draw near to those who seek you. Comfort the dying, console the grieving, and heal the sick, especially Carol, Ron, Jeff, Ed, Debbie, Shirley, John, Janet, Steve, Marietta, Henry, the Cass family, Claudia, Mark, Ivy Ruth, the Amaretta McGee family, Pat, Chris, Jennifer, Margaret, Jeannie, Cliff, Lisa, Haley, Vera, Audrey, Nellie, Pat, Kim, and all those we now name. Lord, in your mercy. For this assembly, give us courage to welcome newcomers graciously. Walk with those who are inquiring, those who harbor doubts and questions, and those who are absent from us. Lord, in your mercy. For Nolan Charles Rourke Davis at his baptism today, together with all the newly baptized, raise him up with your spirit, feed him with your word, and empower him to be your hands in a broken world. Lord, in your mercy. For the birth of a healthy grandson, Spencer Elaham, we include in our prayers Lisa and Carol Wesley. We pray for the safety of travel for those training as Jean Barty and Vicki Donnell attend the Stephen Ministries Leaders Training Course in St. Louis this week. Lord, in your mercy. With thanksgiving, we remember those who have died in faith. Inspire us by their witness. Bring us with them to the heavenly feast. Lord, in your mercy. Joining our voices with your faithful ones of every time and every place, we offer our prayers in the name of the risen Christ, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness to the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ. Praise to you for your spirit poured out on all nations. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith, saying together, "Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again." O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence as we cry out, "Come, Holy Spirit." Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us. Send us forth, burning with justice, peace, and love, as we shout out, "Come, Holy Spirit." With your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Now let us feast this Easter day on Christ, the bread of heaven. Alleluia.
To forget me.
Today, I'd like to share with you a benediction that actually has its origins in Oslo, Norway, with the soup missions there, the soup ministries there. And so I've adapted that just a little bit today. And so I invite you to join. Go. Go and be apostles. Go and never stop going out from church, out from peace and stillness, out into noise and into discomfort, out to tears and to laughter. Carry with you the peace that you were given here as a treasure between your hands and in your heart, and share it again and again and again. It will suffice forever. I invite you also to come. Never stop coming back to this place. Never come with empty hands. Bring with you the doubts and the fears that lock you in. Let them sound out here. Bring with you the hunger that is never stilled, the emptiness that seeks, the fight that is not yet won. Bring with you one who has always been at your side without you knowing it. Here is the meeting place in the light of Christ. Peace be with you. Alleluia.
Thank you. Singing glory, glory.